Baby's healthy and
good right now.
Babies aren't babies anymore, are they?
I know.
Real quickly.
Toddler.
Yeah. I just have a new granddaughter who's 9 pounds, 9 ounces. She was holding her head up after 8 hours out of the womb.
Wow.
I
know. She's strong girl.
Yeah. Awesome.
She looks like a 3-month-old.
Nice. 9 pounds, 9 ounces.
Yeah.
Poor mama.
A little extra.
It was a 3 on the legs.
Oh, wow.
She's lucky.
She's number 3?
Yes.
Yeah, so it gets easier.
It gets.
I didn't want to find out. I stopped her too.
Oh.
My mom had 7, so she probably had 5. Well, what she said was if she knew it was going to take so much
time. But TV isn't on yet.
That's that because now she's seen everything goes.
Oh, yeah.
If you push it once,
it's
it starts.
Yes.
Stand by.
Stand
back.
Because I was the oldest, so you know, the first 5 helped with the last 2 kind of thing.
You need to ask if that's
how I learned about babies.
I take care of babies.
Gordon stayed back, so just in case he wanted to make sure.
She was born 2 weeks after I left.
Oh,
but that's okay.
Yeah.
I got to watch the kids a couple of times.
Did you go to see the
Max? Ran right past right. Went into his room.
Because
I remember
the little
girl was 4 and just went and attached herself. I don't think she's done yet.
Oh.
She's like,
yeah.
She has plans for that baby.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
This is a Upanishad class or this is a
Panchadashi class.
Panchadashi class, okay. I brought the right book. Hello, how are you? Good. Record also, please. You can just put Panchadashi, the date on it. Somewhere right here. Record meeting. Do you see it?
Okay, drop down menu from here.
I think so. Yeah.
Record meeting.
Yeah. So click that, please, and put today's date. Panchadashi and today's date. Sanskrit will also need the mic.
Yes.
Because today they couldn't hear until we went back to all of this. Namaste, Shobha. Nice to be seen by you because I can't see you. Very nice to see everyone here. I'm taking attendance. Visual attendance. All hard-working people. Yeah, they've been at it since 5:30 in the morning. Very proud of all of you. Very nice. Wonderful. Welcome. Some more people there also. Ah, very good. Wonderful. Yes, namaste to you, to everybody else. Om sahana bhavatu, sahana bhunaktu, sahaviryam karavavahai, tejasvinavadhitamastu mavidvishavahai. Om shanti shanti shanti. Does everybody have a handout? May I also have one? Yeah. Thank you. Oh, no,
that's
no,
not
no.
The one?
No.
Oh, no. Sorry. I guess I'll pass it on to you and see if I can get the right one.
Thank you. Perfect. So, welcome to the class on Panchadashi. The Panchadashi is a very big magnum opus, a work by one Swami Vidyaranya, writing in the 16th century. And really his brain is so versatile, and the kinds of metaphors he thinks about, very wonderful. Very erudite scholar. And before he became a monk, before he took on the orange robes, he was a high level chief minister in the Vijayanagar Empire in South India. And the Vijayanagar Empire in the, you know, in South India is one of the, what's it, hallmarks of Indian Renaissance of that period. And so, you know, we are talking of gold, gold, gold everywhere, you know, Lakshmi reigning supreme, abundance, prosperity, spiritual advancement, where all the shastras and everything were given kingly backing. And so I suppose if you are the chief minister, then you get vairagya very quickly, because you have to, what, you know, think of the troubles of the whole kingdom. And then the story goes, and you know, many writers have said this, that even after he took on the robes, the king went, Krishna Devaraya went and told the monk, "You are still, you know, running the kingdom. I'm just doing in your name. You are the one, you know, with whose blessings." And he was a close confidant of the king, supposedly, and he was, you know, very revered. A great scholar, and his Purvashrama name was Madhava. Madhava was his name before he became a Swami. And how do we know that? Because he wrote a Sanskrit book. Not happy with just writing all these wonderful Vedanta books, his career began with writing a Sanskrit book called Madhaviya Dhatu Vritti, a simple book of various, you know, conjugations, declensions, and why they are this way. Very nice book. And now it's an antique. Yeah, we have one in our libraries in the India ashrams. I don't know if it is there in Salisbury. We'll have to check. But so this Madhaviya Dhatu Vritti, he became famous for even before he was a monk. And then after he became a monk, he is very well known for two other works in addition to the Panchadashi. One is called Anubhuti Prakasha. Anubhuti Prakasha is a work it's kind of a decoction of all the Upanishads in pristine verse form. A commentary on the Upanishads in general in verse form. So when there is a commentary on the Upanishads, it is called, what is it called? Karika in verse form. When it is in prose form, what is it called? The commentary? Bhashya. And when the Bhashya is commented upon, what is it called? Vartika in prose. Vartika. You know, Vartika. And then when there is a commentary on the Vartika, of course now we are getting smaller and smaller, it is called Tika. And then Tika, small little, you know, critical notes, cliff notes on the Upanishads. And then finally, there are little footnotes on the Tika, which is called Tippani. So from Bhashya to Tippani, there are rules. You can't just say, you know me, you know what I love to do. I am writing a Karika. You can't just suddenly say that. There are certain rules which one has to follow. What is a Bhashya? There is a rule. Bhashya means it is an original commentary. You can't just, you know, read up Shankara at night and copy him in the morning. It has to be your own work. And then it has to explain the Upanishad or whatever it's commenting on, and then it has to explain itself, like why did I use these words and what do I mean, like this. And so Karika also has certain kinds of, you know, rules that make it a Karika, and that is what was that called? Anubhuti Prakasha. That was one more work that he wrote. And another famous work is called Jivan Mukti Viveka. What is Jivan Mukti? What is Jivan Mukti? You know, free while alive. We are not talking of afterlife. Yeah, right here, right now, free. I mean, who has the time to think of afterlife? You know, afterwards, is there life or not? That itself, I don't know. And where I'm going, I don't know. And even if there is such a thing called heaven, once I go there, will I like it or not? I don't know. All these, so many unknowns are there. What I know is right now, I am miserable. Right now, I suffer from a sense of bondage. Right now, I need to be free. Right now, it's happening now. And so, that is what is Jivan Mukti. That is Vedanta. Living in this dilapidated body with a never mind and senseless senses, you can say, you know, muktoham muktaham, I'm free, I'm okay. Because that I, even though it is apparently living in this body, it's just not afflicted by the physical, the experience of whatever is happening on the level of the physical level. It is not affected at all. And so therefore, he wrote this Jivan Mukti Viveka, another fat book, you know. And in that, what is noteworthy is that even for someone of his time, he could see that there is no difference between women and men, you know, as far as liberation is concerned. Liberation means what? Freedom from samsara is concerned. So in those days, women were not ordained, because, you know, ordination into monkhood means, you know, it was not as cushy as it is now, you know. Now it is, it's much easier to be a sannyasi. Very easy, actually. Yeah, I recommend it highly. And It's so easy to be a sannyasi. You know, you don't have, you know, all kinds of, you know, you don't have to fight mountain lions or, you know, become its lunch. And you don't have to worry about, should I meditate or should I be on a, out on a watch for the bear to come? And, you know, and I should not think about, you know, should I think about scorpions or should I meditate? All this is not there. And whether bhiksha will come or not, that is also not there. You know, and so much easier now. And in those days, since it was difficult, so the women were advised to just have an attitude of vairagya sitting at home itself. What's the fun? No fun. I mean, because they were not ordained, there was no, you know, it was not acknowledged by the society. It was not, you know, it was not a lifestyle recommended for women. But writing at that time, Swami Vidyaranya wrote that there is, you cannot disbar women from wanting this life. Women cannot be disbarred from, just in the introduction itself, in the second page or the third page itself, you will find his statement. So like this, you know, very high caliber thinker, a very free thinker. And so what he does is he writes this 15 chaptered book called Panchadashi, you know. Panchadashi means she who is the 15th chaptered one. Why is the book a she? Huh? Knowledge is always she. Yeah. Shruti, she. Brahma Vidya, she. Upanishad, she. Its knowledge is always feminine. And so for those who pursue the knowledge, you know, it's a feminine pursuit. But what about if I don't pursue the knowledge? What are you pursuing if you don't pursue the knowledge? Money, she, Lakshmi, abundance, she, Aishwarya, power, she. So really, all pursuits are she. Yeah, whatever there is worth pursuing is divided up, is divvied up between Lakshmi and Saraswati. And don't think Saraswati feels jealous because there are more people going for Lakshmi. You know, and fewer come to Saraswati. She's not jealous. She's not insecure. She says, it's okay. Saraswati says, Lakshmi can make you buy a book. You still need my grace to read it and to understand it. She's not worried about it. She knows that the more one is into Lakshmi, after a while one has to come to Saraswati. To even enjoy Lakshmi, you need Saraswati. So between these two women, all the pursuits, you know, from bhukti to mukti are all feminized. And have been divided up, really. And so, that's why Panchadashi is she. That's why it ends in she. Yeah. And so, that is, you know, that is the 15 chapters. Now, one more thing. It is widely believed that only the first 5 chapters Swami Vidyaranya wrote. Ayayo, we are studying which? Chapter 10. So why this long introduction you have given about Vidyaranya? You should have given the introduction of whoever wrote the 10th chapter, because that's what we are studying. However, if you look at a book, Panchadashi, it will always say Swami Vidyaranya by Sri Vidyaranya Swami. A whole book is ascribed to him, you know. This happens a lot. Like half the things which are written, you know, says Shankaracharya, Shankaracharya, Adi Shankaracharya. Adi Shankaracharya would have not touched certain works, you know, with a 10-foot pole, because you can make out from the grammar itself, you can make out from the sentence structure that this is not Adi Shankaracharya, but still it goes under the brand name of Shankaracharya. This was very much a pratha, a custom of those times. in a culture where knowledge is not owned. Knowledge is not owned, and in fact, if I dedicate it to my guru, I feel, greater. I feel like, okay, if it is published in the guru's name, it makes me greater. It doesn't make me any less. In fact, it's greater. So a lot of people, and even if it's not a guru, if it's somebody like of Adi Shankaracharya's caliber, with such, such insight and such erudition, then it is even better. Everybody used to just write under that one name, and like that, so many works have gone under Shankaracharya. Here, that is not what happened. Here he had a friend, a guru bhai, a colleague who studied with the same guru. They both went to a guru called Swami Shankarananda, who was also very, very erudite. He also wrote one book. I forgot the title of it, but he has also written one book of his has survived. And so the guru brother's name was Bharati Tirtha. So it is said that, Swami Vidyaranya gave a head start by writing the first five chapters, and the rest of it is authored by Bharati Tirtha. It is a common belief. But it is published under Swami Vidyaranya. So maybe he read it and he said, oh, you haven't done badly. You've done a good job. Go for it. Write 5 more chapters. Okay. I think we should put a stop. Okay, 15 is a good number. Okay, let's publish it. Maybe that's how it is. So in a way, it is a co-authored work. And scholars, have pointed out the stylistic differences between the first quintet and the second and the third quintets. Quintet means group of 5 chapters. So the first 5 chapters have a certain flair which is, different in the second 5 and the last 5 chapters. Nonetheless, it is arguably the whole work stands on its own, because there is a continuity in terms of the subject matter and in terms of how the subject matter has been dealt with. And what is the continuity? The continuity is that it is a very ambitious unfoldment of the truth of this, the truth of Vedanta, the truth of oneself. It is an extremely ambitious undertaking. Not a single thing it leaves out. Jiva analyzed completely. Ishvara analyzed completely. And then what? Jagat analyzed completely. And then all other small things, 5 elements analyzed completely. There's a big treatise on the 5 elements and their role in this whole situation. The cosmology of creation analyzed completely and then dismissed with also. And then the oneness between Jiva and Ishvara analyzed completely. And whatever is left over in terms of residual, remedial practices that I have to incorporate because the teaching is not understood and there is a little more growing to do, and so what are those mechanisms? Analyzed completely. Not only that, he brings in references from other contemporary works, quaint works. That's how you know that those other scholars were there. It's very much an academic work, the whole thing. And it has a very interesting division also, 5 chapters. So the first 5 chapters end in the word Viveka, like Tattva Viveka. First chapter, Mahavakya Viveka, 5th chapter. So like this, we have the word Viveka, Viveka, Viveka at the end. Then the next 5 chapters, Deepa, 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 Chitra Deepa, Kutastha Deepa, and now Nataka Deepa. Deepa means light. Viveka means enquiry, discrimination. And then what? Finally, the last five chapters, Ananda, Ananda, Ananda. That is the thing. So if you look at it logically, what happens? First there is enquiry, right? Into what? Into the nature and the meaning of the word aham. And what does that enquiry yield? Knowledge, Deepa, the light of knowledge. That light is none other than this consciousness, which is the maker of the universe, which is Ishvara. And that Ishvara is you. That oneness is revealed. And then as a result of that, what happens? Ananda. So there is a certain kind of a building up. And that is why the work is seen as a single work, rather than, you know, this is by Vidyaranya and this is not. We don't worry about that. So this is the whole work. And so this is what Panchadashi is. And if you remember, perhaps vaguely, in the last 2 1-month courses, we have studied one chapter each time. Last time what we studied was the 15th chapter. Yeah, the last one. Then we studied the 8th chapter. Before that, we studied the 8th chapter. And now we are studying the 10th chapter. Why this jumping all over the place? Why not? And oh, previously, long ago, we studied with chapter 4. So 4, right here in this room. Chapter 4, and then what? Chapter 7 we did a little bit, yeah. Chapter 7 did not have the sun rise on it very nicely. Muhurtam must have started in Rahu Kala or something. So, something was a little off. But we were not able to complete that. 7 is a very daunting chapter because it has, I think, 300 verses. That's a lot of verses, okay? Yeah, and but we are not worse off. And now we have, so we did the 4th chapter, then we did the 8th, we jumped to the 8th, 4th, 8th, and then 15th, and then back to 10th. Why are you jumping around like this? You know, why not go from chapter 1 to 15? Well, you know, there are reasons for that. That, you know, only a Vedanta teacher can tell. You know, it's a secret. What is the secret? You look for the shortest chapters. Yeah. Because 1 month course means you have to finish it. This one has, I think, 26, I think, verses. I will be able to complete. You know. And chapter 8 was also not bad, 32 verses, with a little difficulty we completed. Chapter 15 was delightful, with very few verses, you know. So like this, the Vedanta teacher, you know, looks for things that one can complete within 1 month. And so, you are duly cautioned. That is what is also behind the choice of Amrita Bindu Upanishad and Manisha Panchakam, the weekend module. Things, you know, see, anything can be completed. Really speaking, you know, we don't even need all these things to talk about. We can sit and talk. You can just sit and talk. We can, you know, can start off with a topic, any topic, anywhere, and then it will lead back to you. That's really what it is. We don't need all these books or anything. I can sit and talk, you know. But if I do that, then you'll think I'm making this up. I do make up a few things. But this is not, you know, this would not be one of them. But nonetheless, there is that feeling. She's just saying that. This is just her belief. Whereas if this whole history of Swami Vidyaranya and his Purvashrama name, what he did, what he had for breakfast, and how he wrote Panchadashi, or you know, how his friend Bharati Tirtha wrote some other chapters, if all this was not there, and if all this introduction was not presented, and if the, you know, the authenticity of the text was not ratified, And the reasons why to study it was not presented, then it's very easy to think that this is what is called kapola kalpita. Yeah, kapola means skull, kalpita means thinking. You know, what is inside the skull should think, not the skull itself. When the skull starts to think, you have to get worried. Okay, brain cells have to think. So it's very easy to say that somebody has just made this up. But here we have a text from the 15th century, and you cannot say that this is made up. So that's why, you know, we present a text. And then also there is a tremendous feeling of achievement when the chapter is completed. That's another reason to study study it chapter wise. Oh, I have done one more chapter in Panchadashi. And then you can tell all your friends, well, I've studied the fourth chapter, a little bit of the seventh one. You know, as you reach for an appetizer, you can do that. And and then the eighth and the 15th, don't even talk about it. I can recite them in my sleep, you know. You can say that, and everybody, oh, you know, 4 or 5 chapters of Panchadashi, that is tremendous, that is amazing. And then you can just drop some verses, you know. Yeah. Avichara krito bandhaha vicharena nivartate. You know, yes, all bondage is because of no enquiry. Yes, indeed. You know, so there is a tremendous sense of accomplishment. So that is why the chapters are important. Even in Gita, we do the same thing. You know, everybody, whoever is teaching the Gita Acharyas, will first take chapter 12. Only 20 verses. Then chapter 15 is another favorite, because then, you know, it's also chanted before lunch. And so that is another reason to take it. Also very short chapter. So this is what sort of dictates, you know, these are the constraints. Because we can talk even without this, but or we can even take the long chapter. Why not chapter 7, you know, in Panchadashi, and why not try to finish that in 1 month? You can, it's not a problem. But there is some kind of a fun, at least for teachers in the Arsha lineage, Arsha Vidya lineage. And what is the fun? To be able to have some elbow room. Yeah, everything should not be like one verse a day. Oh, I'm behind, now I have to go to verse number, you know, 2. That's not fun. You know, there should be a little bit of time for some dalliances, some cha-cha-cha into this world and the next. And there should be some time to enjoy what we have studied. There should be some time for stories, no matter how little they are pertinent to the text itself. Because everything is pertinent. Sometimes even I wonder, why is this story coming now? But then when I go ahead and just relate and narrate the story, then I know, oh, it's for that person sitting there who was falling asleep. Yeah, immediately the answer comes. Because it helped somebody to wake up. Who am I to stop that, you know? Who am I to stop them from sleeping? And then who am I to stop them from waking up, if that is what is there? So it is all in the flow. So we need a little, you know, elbow room. It's like the dancing, you know, since this whole metaphor is about the dance hall, Nataka Deepa, the dance theatre. So if you give the dancer a small little space, here, this is your stage. Oh, what is that? A small stool, you know, the size of one tile, it's no fun. Yeah, you need some room to just do a little, you know, to go off into what appears to be tangents, but they're not tangents. And we learn how to teach this because of Pujya Swamiji, you know, because of our guru Pujya Swamiji, who was a master at this. He was a master weaver. Weaver of stories, not just weaver of stories into the knowledge. who would weave the stories, and the stories would have the tapestry of the knowledge. And so, you know, when we learn from that kind of a source, it is hard to not, you know, follow that. So therefore, we need a little room to be able to do things. And so that's why this is a very nice, this is a wonderful choice of a chapter. Nataka Deepa, the name of it is called Nataka Deepa. Nataka means what? Dance. Also, theatre, play. Nataka is, you know, for dance or play, drama. And in fact, just like, you know, Swan Lake and all those things, what?
Ballet.
Yeah, the ballet is a dance drama, correct? Mm-hmm. So in the ancient India, they were just like that, you know, kind of like ballets, where the story was enacted through dance, through music, through the accompanists. And so, Nataka Deepa. So essentially the middle five chapters reveal the identity of the jiva with, you know, the whole, with Ishvara, with the Lord. And that is why it is called Deepa, because it is shining the light on the differences. When you shine the light on the differences, what happens? Non-difference is revealed, because the differences really are not there, as we shall see. And so, Nataka Deepa, it's all about, you know, a metaphor, a drishtanta. The word drishtanta means drishta sadrisham, drishta tulyam, that which is like what has been seen, like what has been exemplified. And so the drishtanta means example. And Panchadashi is famous for using a number of examples, numerous examples. And if there is a flaw, I would say it is the overuse of examples. I mean, he just milks the metaphor like there is no tomorrow. Sometimes, you know, he over milks it. Yeah. So if this is one of it, it's actually to the point of weakness in certain places. Not in this chapter. He knows when to quit and he stops. You know. So in this chapter, the very beautiful analogy is given of a lamp in the dance hall or in the theater. Don't think of it as a spotlight. You know, we are not used to this kind of a metaphor. That's why I have to explain it a little bit. Because usually what kind of lights in the theater hall we have? Spotlights. Everything is pitch dark, you don't see the audience. And then whatever needs to be lit up, one dancer, one person saying their lines, monologue, dialogue, whatever it is, that particular area of the stage is lit up with one kind of light. And all the attention is focused on that particular beam of light. That's not the ancient way. The ancient way, whether it was in India or elsewhere, it was like an amphitheater, you know, like a semicircular stage and a semicircular, the seats, the seating arrangements. And then, you know, in between the stage and the seating arrangement, there was a big pillar, you know, like an Olympic torch, a big torch was lit. And that blazing torch was called Nataka Deepa. No shenanigans, no trying to, you know, colored lights and then spotlights and everything else is pitch dark. That's not our way. Everything was lit up. And so, before the dancers came and took their places, before the musical accompanists took their places, before the audience took their places, what was there? Yeah? Nataka Deepa. The lamp was first lit. Because otherwise you should know where you are going. You can't just keep, you know, you can't be one of the things that goes bump in the night. You know, you should know where you are going. So first thing that would be lit was what? Natakadipa, even before the sun came down. And so as the sun came down, the people are enjoying, the people first take their seats, then the accompanists and the musicians come, then finally the artists come, and then the Natakadipa is a unfailing witness. Here are the clues to the chapter. An unfailing witness of all the happenings. And what are the happenings? Audience comes and sits. That's a big happening. And then there is a lot of fanfare. Selfies are being taken, photographs. And fanfare literally comes from, you know, what? You know, in the olden days when these kings and personages came, they were fanned. Or they were surrounded by fanatics. The word fan is short for fanatic, let's not forget. So in either case, people taking selfies, and when the important fellow comes in, you know, a big furor, all this, the soul Natakadipa is looking at is the way he's lighting it up. Simply lighting it up. Natakadipa doesn't take the selfie, it gives the light for the selfie to be taken. Natakadipa is not selfie, it is the self. Okay? Self lends itself to the selfie. That is what Natakadipa does. And then what else does the Natakadipa lights up? You know, riffraff. You know, just the regular people coming from the pubs and the bars, sitting in the back seats because they cannot afford the front seats, you know, the dress circle seats. So they just go, they make a big furor, and then so there are some other people to silence them. And, you know, it lights that up also. Correct? Yeah. You know, just what is that? Not important audience, you know, just regular people coming. Then the musicians come and they sit and entertain as the dancers are getting ready behind the stage. And the Natakadipa lights up the musicians. Then the dancer or the dancers come. All of them come. All these graceful ladies dressed in their finest to give this show. The Natakadipa uncomplainingly lights all of them up. And, you know, and then what happens? 10 o'clock at night, let us say 8 to 10, the performance takes place. After that, what? Time to go home. The last applause has been clapped and the last bow has been taken. And, you know, they go and they come back, they go and they come back. I don't know what that is. Huh? Encore. Encore, I thought you please perform again. They don't, you know, they sometimes, don't perform again.
Sometimes they do a little something.
Yeah, but mostly they just come and, you know, they just get the accolades and then go away. And, you know, to someone like me, you know, when I went to a concert like this, I was very confused. Because I thought it's time to go home. They said, no, they are going to come back. I thought, okay, they are going to come back and they are going to perform something. No, they just came and smiled and waved and everybody stood up and clapped. Then I thought, okay, now they are gone. They came back again. And then I thought, okay, now definitely they are gone. Then they came back for one more time. You know, that is not the Indian way. When you go, that's it. Especially after you have studied Vedanta, when you go, you don't come back, okay? Either in this life or the next, you don't go, you don't go anywhere, you don't come back. Yeah, so final going. And same thing, it is reflected in the iha, not just amutra, iha also, here also. You know, when once the performance is done, you don't come and do little cha-cha-cha bowing, and, you know, with your dress like that. You don't go like that. You know, with one foot behind like Lord Krishna, and you don't go, you know, yeah, like how he is. You know, you don't go like that. You don't do all those, you know, curtsies and pliés and everything. All that is done, you know. And once the namaskar has been done, you go. Correct? So first the dancers leave, then the accompanists leave, and then the audience also leaves. What is still there? Natakadipa. Natakadipa is still there. Very much there. And so that itself is a very beautiful metaphor for the witness that lights us up, the presence as well as the absence of what? Of objects, of thoughts, yeah, of everything, of changes, of movement, everything itself motionless. It lights up both the presence and the absence. Why? Because it is presence personified. It is the embodiment of the word present, Sat. And so it can light up, it can afford to light up the absence because it is not affected by the absence. And we have to stop calling Natakadipa it, it is you. And so very, very gorgeous, you know, very fitting metaphor. And he goes into little more detail. I'm not going to tell all of it now. Let us discover it. And there's more fun in discovering it as we go. And the metaphor, even though it just covers maybe 5-6 verses, since it's a preponderating metaphor, the whole chapter is called Natakadipa, because it's not the whole chapter is not about this metaphor. Only 5-6 verses, maybe 7 verses are revealing this metaphor. But since this metaphor predominates, and since the message of this metaphor, which is the Darshtanta means that which is exemplified, not the example, that which is exemplified. So therefore, what happens? So the whole chapter is called Nataka Deepa. Since we are beginning in, middle of the work, we will still be chanting the prayer written by Swami Vidyaranya to the whole Panchadashi. Very beautiful prayer. So just a wonderful prayer that must not be bypassed. So we are going to chant that at the beginning of every class. So let us chant it now, and then I will explain the meaning. Om Namah Shri Shankarananda.
Namah Shri Shankarananda.
Guru Padambu Janmane.
Guru Padambu Janmane.
Savilasa Mahamoha.
Savilasa Mahamoha.
Graha Grasaika Karmane.
Graha Grasaika Karmane.
Namah Shri Shankarananda. Guru Padambu Janmane.
Guru Padambu Janmane.
Somebody saying Padambu. Padambu Janmane.
Padambu Janmane.
Savilasa Mahamoha.
Savilasa Mahamoha.
Graha Grasaika Karmane. The prayer can be to Bhagavan or to the Guru, and here the prayer is to the Guru. Very beautiful prayer. Namaha means what? Salutations. And that which is the object of the salutation always goes, we know from Sanskrit 101, in the fourth case. Namah Shivaya Ramaya Namaha Vasudevaya Namaha. So the word Namaha takes fourth case. Where is the fourth case here? You know, it is a consonant fourth case. You know, Janmane. But the word Janmane has a few other words tacked on to it. The whole first line, other than the word Namaha, is a compound. So the whole first line is two words. Namaha, one word. Shri Shankarananda Guru Padambu Janmane, you know, word number two. And to top that, the second line is just one word. Savilasa mahamo hagra hagra saika karmane. Ayo Rama, what are we going to do? You know? So that shows the writing caliber of this Swami. Amazing. You know, in the morning Sanskrit class, I told you how you can just make up words as you go along. These are all fantastically made up words in the form of long compounds. So namaha, we know that. Salutations, surrender, namaskaras, unto whom? You know, we'll just go word by word here because there's no other way. Unto Shri Shankarananda, who is my guru. Shankara, you can also take, otherwise you can also take Lord Shankara, who is Ananda. But we, you know, that could be a pun, but we know that his guru's name was Shankarananda. So who is the guru? Who is Shankarananda? And why is he called Shri? Shriya Yuktaha. Shri here is Brahma Vidya, the Nidhi, the treasure. He is sitting upon a treasure chest. Who? This Shankarananda Guru is holding Brahma Vidya. Holding not in the sense of not teaching it, but he is the embodiment of this treasure called self-knowledge. That is the only ornament, that is the only treasure which cannot be stolen. Na chaura haryam na rajya bharam, like this, you know, this vidya is eulogized. This is the only treasure that is not stolen by, that cannot be stolen by thieves and is not a burden to carry. And the more you give, the more it becomes. And, you know, like this, it is eulogized in one of the verses. So beautiful. And so here, Shankarananda is full of this Brahma Vidya in the form of where Saraswati is converted into Lakshmi because of the sheer blessing, presence and the you know, the treasure for the sannyasi and for the jnani, for those who are interested in Vedanta. This is the real treasure, you know. And so the one who is fully endowed with this treasure is called Shri Shankarananda. Brahma Vidyayaha Yuktaha Shankarananda Gurave Namaha. Who is this Shankarananda? What is his glory? You know, that comes in the second line. But a few more things. It's not, the salutation is not directly to Shankarananda. But to what? Guru Pada. Pada means what? Feet. So the namaskar is directed. The salutation is not, you know, hail. It's not like that. It is namaskara. Pada namaskara. It is the bending. You know, this is Vidyaranya, is a very famous Swami. And knows, you know, as much as the teacher does, and knows that I'm no different than the teacher. But that feeling of reverence and devotion has not gone, and that feeling of reverence and devotion is still enacted no matter what. And here, because, you know, we live in this transactional world, and so this is enacted. Inside, no separation, but here, through utmost devotion, what does he say? You know, I'm not saying, you know, I'm not saying salutations. I'm saying namaskaras, namaha. My surrender unto what? Unto the pada of the guru, who is an embodiment of Shri Vidya, which is Brahma Vidya, who is an embodiment of this knowledge of the self, which is revealed as this Nataka Deepa, free of all kinds of problems, free of fears, free of tears, free of afflictions. I am this, you know, my surrender to the feet. And what are these feet? Ambu Janma. Ambu is water. Ambujanma is born of water. What is born of water? Mosquitoes. No, we are only talking of toes, not mosquitoes. What is born of water? Lotus. Ambujanma is the word for lotus. Water born. Ambuja, Ambujanma, it means lotus. And this is a very proverbial way of writing it. You know, when I was writing letters for Pujya Swamiji would receive a lot of letters at your lotus feet. You know, at your holy feet, at your lotus feet. So this is a proverbial way of, you know, saying that the feet are like lotuses. Why feet are like lotuses? Because the lotus grows in the worst possible, you know, environment. In a sludge, untranslatable, only translatable as sludge, called panka. Yeah, sludge. And then it grows, and unaffected by that sludge, because it has certain, both the leaves, the lily pad, and the lotus have some, what is that called? Some kind of small hairs which repel any kind of stick-ons. Cilia. They are the inspiration for non-stick cookware. Must have been, these lotuses. Because even if you take some sludge and throw it on them, it will just fall off on the lotus pad, on the leaf, or on the flower, you know, on the petals. It will fall off. And of course, the lotus becomes a maha metaphor for all those interested in Vedanta. Why? Because the sludge is samsara. Growing in samsara, one is not afflicted by samsara. And so the feet of the guru, even though they are walking in samsara, are like lotuses, unaffected by samsara. And so this is it's a very common metaphor, and a very beautiful one at that. So there are a pair of lotuses that are, you know, unafflicted by samsara. Even though they are walking in the same sludge as I am, still, you know, I'm not able to get myself clean off of samsara, and the guru is scarcely a stain, no affect at all. So that is one of the reasons why Ambujanma, the pada, you know, padav eva Ambujanma, vinu padav means the feet themselves are lotuses, and that is the first reason why the lotus becomes a metaphor. And the second reason, one more thing about the behavior of the lotus, is that it blooms at dawn and closes up tightly at night. So in other words, the sun comes out and makes the lotus bloom. What is the sun? The teaching. The teaching of Brahma Vidya blesses the lotus to bloom. In the Salesburg Gurukulam, Pujya Swamiji designed the temple, you know, the temple doors in the form of an open lotus, the lotus of the heart. When opened, you see the Lord inside. So like this, you know, there are a lot of metaphors like this. And so the lotus is fully open in the light of self-knowledge delivered by the teacher and inhaled, ingested, assimilated by the student. And then the lotus blossoms. What is the lotus? Heart. That is the one and only sign that Vedanta has gone in. Why? There is accommodation. Yeah, one learns to become bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger than anything that confronts one. One learns to soften up, you know, like wax held over a flame. Yeah, you just soften, you just let go, You just are. You just don't have to, you know, think about what will happen if I do this, and, you know, what will happen after that, and then what will happen after that, and then, you know, then one is forgotten what was the first worry. You know, one is worried about the consequence of the worry of the consequence of the worry. What was the first worry? You know? So what, the heart lotus opening, it's a metaphor for compassion. That compassion that reigns, how does compassion reign? You know, by slowly, you know, letting the the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune to rain on one, then one grows into a place of compassion. It's not an overnight, you know, growth. It takes some time. The lotus in the wild opens overnight, but this lotus, you know, takes a few Upanishads, a few lessons on Adhikaritvam, and a few things in order to blossom, because there are a few Shravanams it takes, because few rounds of Shravanams, because there are inhibiting factors, you know. The chill of ragadveshas, the fog of obstructed thinking, so many things. Stop, you know, the clouds of all kinds of anger and fear stop the sun from shining. You know, in an act of self-sabotage, the lotus refuses to open. And so here, the feet are fully blossomed lotuses. Why? Because Swami Shankarananda is a Shrotriya and a Brahmanishtha, has assimilated the teachings from the teacher and is, you know, pickled in the juice of the teachings completely, you know, nimagna, completely, what is that, you know, immersed in the teaching. And such a teacher, unto those lotus feet which symbolize, you know, the opening of the heart through knowledge, themselves fully opened, a fully opened lotus is capable of opening another lotus here, metaphorically. Why? Because a fully opened heart, which is compassionate, is able to inspire another heart to open. To unto this kind of a Shankara, who is the embodiment of Ananda, my salutations. What a first line. Wonderful. Then you say, who is this? Who is this Guru? What do we know him for? And we'll take the last words of the last line. Eka karman, eka karmane. Eka karman means it's a one job Guru. All he does is just one job. Eka karma. Ekam karma yasya. Eka karman. Eka karmane. Fourth case, because it has to go with namaha. Eka karmane. One job person. What is his job? Grasa. Eats. Oh, lot of bhiksha. Keeps eating. What does he eat? Graha. He eats the sharks. Non-vegetarian guru. Seafood, that too endangered, you know. Keeps eating sharks, I don't know. I mean, good for omega-3s, I suppose. You know, but, and will never get arthritis because there is chondritin, you know. Shark cartilage, which they are taking for arthritis now. Poor sharks, really, I mean, you know. Anyhow, so then, so this guru is very limber because eating sharks all day. What kind of sharks? Mahamohagraha, the sharks of great delusion. I'm going to go over by a few minutes. I'm telling now itself. Oh, perfect time, yeah. So, I'm going to go over because it's not nice to leave it hanging. So, says that, what is that? Mahamoha, not just moha. Delusion is, you know, that I don't know myself. That is delusion. Mahamoha is what? Because of which I take myself to be an idiot. This is Mahamoha. I take everything that is unreal to be real, and this is what is the, is a big problem. So Mahamoha Graha is the shark of great delusion. And why is it a shark? Because jaws. Yeah, it was so electrifying, they even made a sequel. Yeah. It has its jaws open. What is this? Delusion. Delusion comes with a pair of the biggest jaws in the world, which are permanently open and directed at you. They come like this. And the shark, you know, things like shark, crocodile, half the animal is teeth, you know. The other half little tail and a few other body parts. And it is coming after you with open jaws. Meaning, it's a very scary scenario, right? And so, in a world where the big fish eats the small fish, we need the guru to be the biggest fish that will eat this great grand fish of my own delusion. Why is the delusion a fish? Because even Swami Vidyaranya, maybe he didn't know English, he knew that something was fishy about this delusion. That's why he embodied this fish in the form of delusion. Very fishy. He knew something was not right. So, this fish of delusion, big shark, is after me. And what does the guru do? Swaha. Through the teaching. Swaha. And that is the only job. Mahamoha grasanam, Mahamoha grahanam grasaha, the eater of the sharks of great delusion about myself, about the world, about Ishvara, if there is one, and about all this, I am thoroughly deluded, because of which I am under the grip of tears and fears. And the guru doesn't come with a hanky and wipe the tears. It's a band-aid approach. Hanky-panky guru. No, we don't need that kind of a guru. We need a guru that will take the cause of the fear and the sorrow away. You don't need a guru who says, there, there. No. You need somebody who will take the cause of the fear away, and here the great grand sharks of delusion are gone because the guru called Shankarananda has eaten and burped them up. They are not there at all, gone, digested. That's why burp, digested completely. And Savilasa means, those sharks, unfortunately, they don't come singly. They come with their friends and relatives. If Mahamoha is self-delusion, then the sharks are what? All the broods of self-delusion and self-ignorance. What are the broods of self-ignorance? I told you, ignorance has a family tree. Ignorance has a child. What is that? Kama. Because I don't know the truth of myself, I desire all kinds of nonsensical things. Then in order to actualize those desires, I have to run around in the world frustrated. Karma. The grand child of avidya. Avidya, maha matriarch, and then Kama, first son, then the son of the son, karma. And then what? Twins. Punya, papa, karma, phala. The result of action. And then what? Punar janma. Rebirth and reruns of the same life again and again. In a new, old wine in new containers. Wine is spelled W-H-I-N-E. Okay? Yeah. That's what it is. Same wine in a new containers, whining, one is born. Again and again and again, whining. Just a new body to whine with, new voice. Last time nasal voice, this time shrill voice. Same thing. And this is the brood. The shark never comes singly. Savilasa means along with the family. You know, in every Indian invitation card, please come to the wedding of our son on such and such a day, along with friends and family, which is a stark change from the American wedding card. They will not even invite the significant other, only you. Then you have to call. What about my spouse? No, only you, because one more plate we have to get. It's because, you know, the costs of food and all, it's too much here. Everything costs money. And so like this, here the shark comes along without invitation. The shark of ignorance comes along with friends and family to your wedding with samsara. This is what it is. And so therefore, the guru, what does the guru has done here? Has swallowed up the shark along with the friends and family. No sign of samsara anywhere. And so the student can heave a sigh of relief and continue to do the shravanam of chapter 10. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. That idea for questions that Nipun gave, is Nipun here? From Bhopal, if Nipun is here, is he here? I don't know. Nipun gave a very nice idea, you know. And what he said was that the questions can be written and what you can do is you can email them to you, right? Yeah, you can email them on the same address where you signed up. And and put in the subject satsang questions, and I will answer them in the class. So that will be very nice. And Nivedita has written notes on today's lecture and she's sharing them with all of you. Thank you, Nivedita. Very nice. Very nice of you. People have been very helpful, because it's not easy to put something like this together, and somebody made a calendar and somebody has, you know, helped with all of this. So thanks to everybody. Yeah, wonderful.
Padmini.
Yes. Ah, oh, very nice, Padmini. Who?
Mangesh.
Yes, wonderful. Namaste to everyone. Yes, and you know, there are people who are joining for the first time. There are about 170 people registered for this course, but you will not see all of them at once because there are several tracts. And so, you know, different groups will be taking different texts. Okay? All right. See you all tomorrow. Tomorrow you have 3 levels of Sanskrit starting at 7:30 Pacific time. And then Bhagavad Gita in the afternoon, and in the evening Amrita Bindu Upanishad, and then meditation. Okay? All right. Oh, thank you. I'm glad.